In the 1970s, there was a lot of thinking about what did environmental change mean for people, a lot of interesting speculation. In the 1990s, after the Rio Earth Summit, there was another wave of thinking about this, and since 2007 IPCC reports, there's been a third wave. And over time, as the science has matured, the social science thinking about what this implies has matured as well. That doesn't mean that there aren't many uncertainties and lots of things we don't understand well. I am going to start by creating a bit of a context for my comment. In the field that I represent, in the field of security studies, this field was built around the assumption that social problems almost always had social causes. So if we wanted to understand why things collapsed, why things broke down, why wars started, we looked for social variables. And in fact, we identified three of these as explaining an awful lot of what our security challenges were. We thought of ideological rivalry. We thought of the unequal distribution of power. We thought of economic competition. And we came up with security policies to deal with each of those things. We needed to contain our ideological adversaries. We needed to build up a powerful army so we could not be dominated. We needed to encourage a system that we believed in, a system of openness and trade. And we did all those things throughout the 20th century. And we became, and I'm not suggesting that we ever fully understood security, but we had it simplified down and we didn't think much about the environment. Now, when the Cold War ended, there was this opportunity to ask ourselves, well, communism has been largely contained or defeated. A global trade order has been established with institutions that we understand. Great power war seems to have been something that has declined in probability dramatically. What's next? What's next? And many people began to ask the question, okay, well, one of the things what is next is partly going to be a legacy of what took place in the 20th century. And one of the things that took place in the 20th century was an acceleration of environmental change. And so a small group of people said, is this going to be relevant to how social systems are able to function? Is this going to cause some of them to break down? Is this going to cause some of them to compete in ways which will lead to violence? And so we had never really had much experience taking data from science and trying to bring it into the social science realm. But there was a sort of, and I don't want to suggest that everybody was doing this. In fact, it was a rather small group of people. But it turned out there was an opening after the end of the Cold War because the Clinton-Gore administration was receptive to this. And they were looking around for understandings of what happened in Rwanda and what is happening in Haiti and what is happening in Somalia. And people started to say, well, let's look at water scarcity. Let's look at land stress. Let's look at how people are meeting their basic needs and the struggle. And that might help us understand what's happening in Haiti or what's happening in Rwanda or what's happening in Somalia. And this led to, and as I say, it was a small group of people, but it led to a number of findings. And before I briefly summarize those, I want to point out that there's still a lot of uncertainty in bringing together the complex social world and the changes that are taking place there and the complex environmental or ecological world and the changes that are taking place in there. So we're taking two areas of complexity and uncertainty and trying to understand how they interact and what sort of feedback mechanisms exist and how changes in one might affect changes in another. This is a fairly complicated undertaking. And so we're not at the point where we can say we understand it as well as we would like. Lots of propositions, though. One is that there seem to be strong correlations between areas that have certain types of environmental scarcity and certain types of violent conflict, or that have high-value lootable resources like diamonds or gold and conflict. So we looked at that and we said, this does not mean causation, but there's a very strong correlation. Places that experience land scarcity. As we look back through history, we discovered that actually it's a pretty powerful correlation. And places that experience land scarcity also tend to experience a lot of social upheaval. State failure. when institutions are not able to provide basic services to their people and lose the trust and legitimacy. So even if there isn't war, there's often breakdowns. What we're seeing in Nepal today, the war has ended in Nepal, but the government is not able to provide even very fundamental services. And as a result, you have throughout Nepal constant riots, constant work stoppages, constant people taking into the streets and bringing everything to a halt. And of course, in our country and in every country, we said, is there also a relationship between changes in the environment and different elements of our national power? This led to an interesting question that got a lot of attention. We still don't have all the data, but the question, it seemed ironic. If environmental change might cause security problems, it seemed ironic that military activities were themselves a major force in terms of global environmental change. In fact, militaries of the world produce a significant percentage of greenhouse gases, for example, and manage a significant amount of land, and so on. So people said, there's an interesting irony. If this is ushering in the next wave of challenges, then part of the solution might be for the military to reduce its own environmental footprint. And people said, this is also an opportunity for us to ask, you know, do we just want to focus on environmental change in terms of the potential for things like war and state collapse? Or do we also want to look below this at other types of problems? Could environmental change be a factor in perpetuating poverty or making development difficult? Is it linked to migration that's unwanted? Is it linked to things like disease? People looked at what happens to the environment during a war. And this is what I do. Most of my career has been spent working in war zones and looking at the environment there. And we discovered that, wow, natural resources can fund war. They can provide new motivations for war, which make it very difficult to end. They can be damaged by war. And this means that in those post-war and post-disaster situations, the environment is an important thing to think about. It's interestingly enough, when people said, how do we rebuild a country after a major war? They said, well, get the economy going, rebuild trust in the government, make sure, professionalize the police and military so people aren't afraid anymore, and give people some opportunity for reconciliation. And they did not consider at all questions of water or land or energy. And so much of my career has been spent on trying to persuade the Peace Building Commission in the UN to accept this. And 3 or 4 years ago, they did. We presented a rationale for this. The UN accepted it, and we began to integrate formally natural resource management and climate change adaptation into peace-building activities, and I was lucky to lead the first effort to do this in Sierra Leone. Because we know that natural resources, think of a place like Rwanda. As the genocide came to an end, 2 million people moved into Rwanda, and the first thing they did was try to find a place to live. And they settled on steep hillsides, and they settled in marshes, and they settled in protected areas in a completely unregulated fashion. And today, we look at the situation in Rwanda, massive land scarcity, almost no forest cover anymore, marshlands that are heavily polluted, and we think much of this could have been avoided if we had made a few careful decisions in those early years. But now we're stuck with that situation. Most people after 2007 assumed that the impacts of climate change would simply be to amplify these relationships, which admittedly we did not understand very well. But they said, if water scarcity can drive things like climate change or be an obstruction to development, then more water scarcity, if it's related to climate change, can only be a bad thing. It cannot be a particularly good thing. It's going to complicate peace building if we now have to consider not only stabilizing the economy and restoring the competence of the government and professionalizing the military and developing a regime for resource management, but also think about what's going to happen to this country from a climate change perspective over the next 20 or 30 years that might change our goals. And of course, there are things like double exposure events. A lot of countries seem to be not only prone to conflict, but also to disaster. And there's this concern about things that may occur that we don't even know about. All right. I want to make sure that you realize that not everybody agrees with this. Some people do not like the idea of linking the term security to the environment because they think that this forces us inevitably into a world of military and secrecy and intelligence and so on. And there's some concerns there. Some people think that actually scarcity and environmental stress will tend to trigger ingenuity and create conditions for cooperation. And the historical record is certainly mixed in this regard. There's been lots of innovation, but also a fair amount of institutional breakdown and collapse. So we have lots of uncertainty. And you know, say it once again, we have imperfect understandings about what's going on. We've got concerns about glacial melt and snow melt in South Asia. There's a number of scientists who are saying that at higher altitudes, has reached some sort of equilibrium point. It's not quite as the way many policymakers have understood it. This does provide a significant, but it isn't the most important part of the stream flow, which feeds those rivers that everybody knows a third of the world depends upon. Changes can certainly put a lot of stress in some areas at certain times of the year. And there are legitimate concerns about glacial lake outburst floods and landslide lake outburst floods, especially in places like Nepal and Bhutan. Changes in the timing of the monsoon for what are largely agricultural economies certainly raises some red flags. But there's a lot of uncertainty about this huge hydrological system in this very mountainous area. So it isn't like we can say, these are the clear and distinct trends, everybody's in agreement, and we can figure out how they're going to play out as they work their way through water management institutions or cross borders or deal with, you know, rapidly urbanizing parts of South Asia. So it isn't simply that we've got this stable universe of knowledge that we need to simply apply. In my world, people very quickly jumped on board. They saw the 2007 reports, and then they looked at things like 2010, floods, landslides, fires. They said, what explains floods, landslides, and fires? Well, we know what explains it. What explains it is climate change. And we know that when we look at various analyses of the vulnerability of these countries, we've got something that appears at first blush quite simple. Climate stress is increasing floods and landslides in areas which are very vulnerable to these things, and there's an awful lot of people there, and this is going to be a constant source of disaster, humanitarian crisis, concern for the world. But before we get there, I think that, and I'm not suggesting that there aren't important implications, before we jump to that conclusion, we have to take a more careful look at what's happening. This is a very large, complicated region undergoing a major economic and political transformation on a scale that is completely unprecedented. Never have we seen before an agricultural economy of that size transform towards a service and industry-based economy. Never have we seen urbanization at that pace on that scale. Never have we seen population growth take place. So you've got an awful lot taking place socially. And some of it is good. And it is very easy for us to stereotype things. You know, if you talk to some people, Bangladesh, I saw it on the cover of Time magazine, the basket case of the planet. If you talk to a lot of people from Bangladesh, people in Dhaka are becoming overnight millionaires because of the increase in real estate. The economy's growing at 8%. They predict that they'll be in double-digit growth in a few years, that they will become a middle-class country by 2021. Maybe optimistic, but the point is, it isn't perfectly black or perfectly white. And what we have is a huge transformation taking place, and it's very complicated. So just as it's complicated to understand hydrology of this area, it's complicated to understand its social transformation. We know it's changing, though. We know it's changing dramatically. Some of the big changes. As many as 1.6 billion people could be added to this area, fed by these 10 rivers that come from the Hindu Kush and the Himalayas. Urbanization is taking place at an unprecedented speed. There are going to be half a dozen mega cities crop up in the next 10 or 15 years. Same with coastal growth. India is emerging as potentially an economic superpower. You have this massive growth of middle class throughout South Asia and, of course, China. The very, very quick collapse of traditional systems. So there you have people who have generations have made their living in fisheries or farming, and very, very quickly those opportunities are disappearing for them, and they're being moved into urban areas or forced to find other ways of surviving. Energy consumption is climbing at a rate that's unprecedented. And we have a lot of weak political institutions. The failed state index puts South Asian countries at the very top of countries that have massive political problems, that have a hard time governing themselves. We have a history of violent conflict, which is a great predictor of the next generation of violent conflict. So if you've had violent conflict in the last 10 or 15 years, you're more likely to experience it again than countries that have not. We have a huge diffusion of new technologies, some for good, some for bad. Nobody fully understands the point that I'm trying to make is the implications of all these changes. And we need to avoid simple analysis. We need to avoid what you hear in the policy world. There's going to be glacial melt. This will be, first we'll get a decade of floods, and then there'll be permanent drought. And so we have to plan around that. But really, that's not what science is telling us. Science doesn't say exactly that. So one of the big challenges is just for policymakers to better understand what scientists are in fact saying. We also have to move away from some of the stereotypes of the region that we have, especially of places like Bangladesh and Nepal and Pakistan, which we have simplified down. And these are actually quite complex systems with things happening in a lot of different directions. So climate change is going to be important. There's no doubt about it. I'm sure you've been listening to that. The decline in groundwater storage seems to be really, really important. But what we're not sure about yet is whether all this is going to be basically a weak signal in very complex systems that are transforming very rapidly. And so we don't want to overemphasize the importance of this, or whether this is the sort of variable that could push these systems to the point where they're overwhelmed and they can't manage the transformation. And we don't know. We do not know which direction things will go in, but we have good reasons to be concerned. That is, I'm suggesting that there's lots of positive signs, rapid economic growth, and so on, but there's also lots of reasons to be concerned. And some of the things that we worry about are could environmental stresses, including declines in groundwater storage and the pressures linked to climate change and so on, could they intensify traditional security concerns? We're already seeing more and more conflict around water agreements, water institutions, the distribution of water in the region. What level, how might this advance in the next few years? This is a major area of concern. We're concerned also, we've seen people begin to say, you know, India said, we will not open discussions about the treaty that manages the Indus River unless you, Pakistan, manage terrorism against us more effectively. But we also see another type of linkage taking shape. People saying, well, these problems are caused because the West has ransacked our environment and the global environment. So we're struggling, we're facing massive obstructions to development, to transformation, because of consumption habits of the West which are not changing. So we're getting these, and there are other types of concerns like the fate of the Maldives and so on. I think a big area is this natural transition which much of the world has gone through from agricultural economies to other types of economies. We're not sure how this is going to play out as the extremes of flooding and drought start to move out this way. And you've got to negotiate this transition in what might be a more volatile in natural environment than has been the case in the past. We're not sure if the huge gains made in public health in the years after HIV/AIDS turned this into a global agenda item, if those could be rolled back by these sorts of environmental stresses. And that's a big concern. There's lots of wild predictions about what will happen to people. It seems that the dramatic ones that are headline grabbing, like 200 million people could be displaced by flood, have absolutely no real empirical basis or historical basis for them. They're sort of conjured up and then repeated until policymakers start to believe them and then start to say, well, we got to do something about this because this could be a huge problem. So we have to be careful about these things. We do know, however, that with greater extremes, more disasters, it takes state capacity away, and when you've already got weak states that are vulnerable to these things, very difficult to invest in the infrastructure and other things that are needed to manage the transition. So the development challenges are going to be potentially significant as we see these sorts of environmental impacts. We also have to ask the question, do policymakers have to plan for surprises? Because climate scientists keep holding out as the possibility that there could be a sudden dramatic change that takes us all by surprise. And of course, that's the last thing policymakers want to hear, is that there could be some sudden dramatic change, because they're saying, what does this mean as we build infrastructure and bring things together? And if you're a policymaker, you look at a place like this. These are photographs I took while I was doing research in northern Pakistan. It's pretty thin infrastructure up there. This is the major road. This is the road, the single road that connects Peshawar, Islamabad, Peshawar, up to Gilgit, Chitral, towards China. So everything goes up and down this road for the few months of the year that it's open. And it's a rough road. And you can see why a little more flooding is not going to be kind to this type of infrastructure. This is how everything moves up and down that road. It moves so slowly, by the way, that you can walk alongside these vehicles. Driving up and down them, I had a driver, I have to admit, fascinating experience. But you can see the vulnerability of these small communities and the threat that with deforestation and more flooding, lifestyles that have been in place for generations could suddenly and very quickly change. And what are these people going to do? Because the numbers are not small. The numbers are big. And they can't be moved into urban settings over the course of two or three generations. It's happening in the space of years and so on. So as these things disappear, that's a huge problem. When we get news like this, we can understand numbers like this. We can understand, and these are crude early numbers. But a couple of things happened with the big floods, which I don't think anybody thinks were mainly to be explained by climate change. This is misuse of groundwater and poor drainage systems and weak infrastructure and bad water management. There's a whole lot of things going on here. But basically what happened is a whole lot of people were hurt by this, and the institutions were further weakened as their level of corruption manifests itself during the response. The end result, and my final words, is that a number of people have said, when you look at this, yes, it's uncertain, but here's what we should be planning for: catastrophe. We don't know for sure, but the smart money, when we look back at what happened to the Roman Empire, we look back at what happened to the Mayan Empire, or whatever we want, the smart money, Soviet Union, is on catastrophe. And that's what we should be thinking about as policymakers. How are we going to rebuild a Pakistan that finally collapses, an Afghanistan that collapses, or how are we going to rebuild more and more places that look like Afghanistan today? If we suddenly have 40 countries like that, how are we going to do that? Other people say, no, we're wildly underestimating the human capacity to adapt, to innovate. The incredible, and one thing that you see in South Asia, entrepreneurs, agile, risk-taking. People are becoming millionaires very quickly in that world. There's a lot of very agile people developing products to meet the real needs of the world's emerging middle class. Simple technologies that are meeting real needs. So it isn't, should we be preparing for the worst, or should we be trying to reinforce what we think are the strengths of the region, its ability to innovate, to adapt, to overcome these things? Or I think probably the middle position that many people find favorable is the really poor people are screwed, and the people who are less poor are considerably less screwed in the next two decades. And so if you're really poor, the future is bleak in an area of floods and droughts and so on. If you're not so badly off, you have some options, and there are going to be various strategies available to you for coping. We need to do a lot so that we can make better decisions. We need to bring, I think, one of the things we have not brought together adequately is social science and natural sciences. That's why I think these sorts of events are particularly important. It certainly changes the perspective of social scientists if they spend a little bit more time listening to their counterparts in chemistry and physics debate these issues, rather than running with the journalistic accounts, which sometimes are only the the tip of the knowledge base that we have. With better understanding, we can make some smart decisions about, should we just be reinforcing development, basic development in these areas? Should we be, you know, bringing together traditional knowledge and climate science to create more opportunities for adaptation? What should we be doing? I think that some of the things that have emerged through discussions in my world is that you can't go wrong by continuing basic development programs. This builds resilience in lots of people. That in South Asia, one clear disaster, I've never heard anybody say this was a good idea, was unregulated, mismanaged tube wells. So moving back to the traditional system of shared communal water storage and water management seems to make a lot of sense. It is remarkable when you're sitting in a room with people from that region how awkward they are at sharing information about what is going on the river systems that they share and so on and so forth. So better information sharing, almost certainly. We know that people are adaptive and innovative, and we know that a lot of the people there, we're talking about extremes, but not things that they have no knowledge about. So better understanding the local capabilities for adaptation and innovation and bringing those into dialogue with our thinking is probably a valuable thing. And we have to carefully assess how the infrastructure develops. Are the dams and the hydropower that are taking shape there, are they basically a good idea and they're going to bring the place energy it needs and improve water storage? Or are they basically a bad idea monkeying with a large hydrological system that we don't really understand very well? So my point is it's not all bleak, but there are serious grounds for being concerned about the way things will play out. And I think that this is a dramatic moment because South Asia is something unlike what we have seen in world history. Thanks very much.